Okay, what's going on, everybody? My name is Mang, and we have had enough build-up. It is time to finally begin the Shadowrun campaign, and that's what we did tonight. Yeah, we were all very excited. We didn't know what was going to happen, but we're going to go into it with gusto. And so, to kind of recap, I guess. Character I'm playing is Gug. Real name, Rufus Wise. Gug was corporate-born, corporate-educated. Graduated from the University of Washington with a double major in neuropsychopharmacology and cyber engineering. So he's no dummy. But he kind of got fed up with the whole corporate life. And he basically hired somebody to get him out of there. To just kind of erase him from existence. And he moved to Milwaukee, Wisconsin to kind of start a new life. There he met up with his good buddy Gulk, and the rest is kind of history. He also met with he did some shadow running to kind of make some money for his drug empire, which I'll get to. And so he started shadow running, went with another team that didn't really work out. They kind of got captured and busted, and he kind of ditched them. Not really on purpose, it's just kind of how it happened. And that's where he ended up now with the current team, which includes Smoove, who's our face. He is he's an elf, a very charismatic elf. We have Dante, who is our muscle, I guess. He's an adept, which basically means he's like Neo from the Matrix, more or less. He's ridiculous. And then we have Thomas, who is a pixie rigger. And again, a rigger can just kind of jump into vehicles and control drones and all sorts of stuff like that. So that's our current team, and that's how we started. So we started the session at Nacho Mama's, which is, of course, our usual spot, our usual hangout. Actually, no, it's really not our usual hangout. But I guess it's where we do meetings in person about meetings, or about runs. And so we met there with our fixer contact, Mark Murphy, Marcus Murphy. And he gave us some tips, some hot tips. So the main one was that he had a meeting arranged for us with a Mr. Johnson. It's not the real guy's name, Mr. Johnson's just what people call, shadowed figures that want to hire runners to do a job. That's just what they're called. So he had a meeting with a Mr. Johnson that was going to happen at a baseball game. And we were only supposed to send the face to the meeting. So that's what Smoove was going to do. Then we had another tip about a Lone Star sergeant named John Stratton, I believe. And apparently Lone Star was looking to hire a group of runners for some sort of job. So we were supposed to get in contact with him. And then finally, Mark Murphy himself said that he was looking for gold bars. And he would be willing to pay 500 New Yen an ounce for gold, which is a pretty good price. So basically, we just kind of had to look for a lot of stuff. So we all set out from Nacho Mama's. Smoove was going to go to the baseball game to do that meeting, and I was going to be tapped into his eyes and ears so I could kind of follow along, help him out. Then the rest of us were going to kind of handle this gold bar slash the Lone Star thing. So I found out this John Stratton's contact info, and we basically said that we have just like a group chat, like a group text chat that we can all just put text messages into, and we all just see it. We get notifications, things like that. So I put his contact info into our group chat, and Smoove sent him a text message saying that, hey, you know, I heard you're looking to hire some people. When do you want to meet? And he basically responded. He was at the shooting range inside of a club that Dante frequented, and he was there at the same time. So this guy said he'll meet us at this club tonight at like 7 o'clock. We're like, all right, we'll be there. Meanwhile, okay, so here's the thing about my character and what I'm kind of doing. So if you follow along with what I do, I recently finished watching Breaking Bad, and of course, so being such an incredible show, it kind of influenced me a little bit, at least for a character here. So I was like, okay, so Gug, he's really smart. He does the decking thing. He does the hacking thing. But what if he's also, you know, he wants to make even more money. So how about drugs? There's a lot of money in drugs. And so I'm like, okay, maybe he could be like a cook. You know, he could be like the Walter White of Milwaukee. I basically kind of did the same thing where I just took like a base drug and I just made it like amazing. So I took the base drug Cram, which is basically the future equivalent of meth. It just makes you really hyper and paranoid and alert and all that kind of stuff. I took that and I just kind of refined it and made it like double the potency. And so the idea was to double the potency and kind of half the crash effect. So it'd really just be like a super cram. It would be great. And we would sell it only to the high-class, high-rise, penthouse kind of users that would shell out $1,000 a pop. Because the way I figure it, you know, these people in this world, they thrive on kind of just exclusivity. They thrive on being elitist. You know, and so if I kind of make this kind of artificial market where it's like, no, I won't sell to him. He's not good enough, but I'll sell to you. And so these people are like, oh man, I want to get to that level where I can buy that kind of exclusive, that exclusive drug. I'll pay $1,000 a pop for it every week, you know, or something like that. Multiple hits, you know, boom, boom, boom. That's rolling in the dough, man. You get them addicted. They just shell out $1,000 a pop. I pay 20% off the top to my dealers and, you know, we're in business. That's kind of the idea. And really, they don't know that its base form is just cram that I made good. They just know it's the hottest shit on the streets. And so I call it vitesse, after the French word for speed, because I figured that makes sense. Gug is a character who speaks French. He would do something like that. And so I have this whole warehouse rented out. I have this kind of rundown, abandoned warehouse that I rent out. And it used to be owned by an electromotive company, and so it's filled with like these crates full of like electromotive parts, junk parts, and stuff like that. And so I kind of just kept all that shit so people think it's abandoned. And in the way in the back, I just kind of have a chemical sealed tent set up where I do all the cooking. So I head over there with Gulk, and I'm like, all right, we theoretically this is all good on paper, but we need to actually test it out on a live subject. So you're going to go out there on the streets, and we're not going to try to sell this to anybody that would, you know, remember our product for later. So we need to sell this just a common bum, you know, a common cram addict or something, and see how they react to it. So just go out there and sell it just for the normal price, $10 a hit, and just kind of observe, see what happens. He's like, okay, I'll do that later. So yeah, I have Gulk as a pusher, if you're curious. That's what he's become. He's been everything from just comic relief to Nier Lethotep to now a drug dealer. So there you go. Gulk is just the everyman. Okay. So Smoove goes to this meeting at the baseball stadium. And I'm in there because I'm connected to his cyber eyes. I'm connected to his cyber ears. Or I think he might just have earbuds. I'm connected to his comm link. So I'm hearing everything that's going on. I'm seeing everything that's going on. And he goes there and he meets with a guy who basically rented out like a whole row of seats for himself. And he's got a couple bodyguards there. And Smoove's seat is right next to him. And so since I'm tapped into his cyber eyes, I can see this guy's face. And so I go on the Matrix then, and I do some sort of facial recognition. And the thing is, this was actually not even my idea, to be honest. I didn't even think of it. Smoove actually thought of it. It was commendable. The thing is, with like Shadowrun, the Matrix, and all the tech, there are rules for so many things. There really is. There are rules for a lot of things in Shadowrun. But there are probably even... there's more stuff that there isn't rules for that come up during a game where it's just like, I want to do this. Because you're just thinking. You're just, I should be able to do this. What are the rules for it? And they're not going to be rules for it. Like, I don't think there's rules for running facial recognition. Like, what do you roll? Like, you have no idea. I think it just comes down to a Matrix search test. And so I think that's what we did. And so I found out that this guy works for Mitsuhama. Mitsuhama Computer Technologies, which is run out of Beijing, I believe, or Hong Kong, or something like... no, not Hong Kong, because that's Wuxing. Hold on. I guess I want to find out. I want to be sure. Oh, I think it might be Japan. Yeah, it would have to be Japan. Yeah, Kyoto is their world headquarters. So yeah, they're out of Kyoto, and they kind of they're all about computers, robotics, all that kind of things. And there's a rumor that they're working with the Yakuza. Although the book says there's a rumor going around that they're in bed with the Yakuza. Who am I kidding? They're all over each other. So yeah, they're probably highly in league with the Yakuza. And so, yeah, we find out then who we're working for, which is really not what you want as a Mr. Johnson. You don't want to ever be found out who you work for, because then that's kind of leverage for later on. And I think we found out his name was like Lo P or something like that, which is a Chinese name, even though he's working for a Japanese company. I don't know. Smoove does all the talking here. And I'm just kind of in his ear providing sarcastic comments and things like that. And so we find out the job. We find out our main job. And it's a wet work. It's a wet work job, which means it's an assassination. It's a hit. The target is a guy named Li Wangzhong or something like that, which is also a Chinese name, although I think he's meant to be Japanese, but I have no idea. And so this guy, we don't get to know anything about him. All we get to know is that he recently arrived in Milwaukee, like yesterday or something like that. We're meant to find him and kill him. That's our job. like, that's it. And the pay for the job was originally $15,000. That's $15,000 for our whole group of four, which would boil down to... I don't know, 3,250? That doesn't sound right. No, that's not right at all. 3,500? It's some sort of number. It's not high. It's not a high number. And, you kind of got to put these things in perspective. 3,000... let's say... I think it's 3,500. No, it can't be. Man, now I have to check calculator because I'm so terrible at math. People are just like yelling at me. Mang, how do you not know how to do basic division? No, that's not right. Hold on. Jeez, now I can't even work a calculator. Oh my god, I can't. I really can't. Good thing you can't see my screen because it's terrible. It's so terrible. I have no idea how to work a calculator. 3,750. Right, okay. 3,750 new yen. So how much is that? Yeah, how much? What does that really get you? The answer, not much. Let's say, take a basic pistol. Like, say I just want a basic pistol for security. You can get a pistol for like $300. So that's pretty basic. You get a better pistol for like $600. What if I want like something that packs more firepower? What if I want like a submachine gun? Okay, you're looking at $900. What if I want like an assault rifle? Okay, well that could go up to maybe like $2,000 or something. And then you go up to sniper rifles. You want a good sniper rifle? Okay, how about, I don't know, $17,000. So that's a little ridiculous. You're not going to really get much of a sniper rifle from this job. You may be able to get an assault rifle, but what about other stuff? What about, I don't know. You're not going to get a cyber deck, that's for sure. Comlink, you know, an okay comlink will cost you maybe $700, $1,000. So you could get one of those. You could get maybe the worst rated fake sin, which is not good. Sins are expensive. What about, like, augment? What cyberware? What about that? How much does that cost? Where is it? Cyber eyes. The most basic, cheapest cyber eyes you can get are 4,000 new yen. So you wouldn't be able to get cyber eyes from this one job. So the point is, I guess, it's not really that much money. To put it really, really into perspective, totally into perspective in relation to us, our goal as a group is to get enough money to buy our own plane so that we can fly to somewhere else that is more lucrative, a more lucrative area with bigger megacorps and better runs and things like that. We settled on Hong Kong because we figure that's really cool. So the plane that we're pretty much interested in buying, we thought about getting the Cessna C-750, but it only has four seats. There's four of us, but we also have like Gulk and one other person, something like that. It just really wouldn't work. So then we have to upgrade to the RF Fokker Tundra 9, which has 24 seats. It's 300,000 new yen. So yeah, if we get paid 15 grand for a job, it's not going to be much. So Smoove tried to kind of hardball the guy and to get more money. Because we're doing wet work. We got to find this guy. We have no idea where he is. This is some, you know, not any group could just do this. So give us some more. So he changed the deal to 10 grand. And he'll give us a rental car that he owns, I guess, that he's using. He's not going to need it once he leaves. So he'll give it to us. And the rental car is an Ares Roadmaster, which is basically like a big van, more or less. And the Ares Roadmaster is worth about 52 grand. Actually, no. I'm thinking of something later. What was his? Oh, the Hyundai Shinyoung. That's what it was, which is 28 grand. So 28 grand vehicle plus the 10K. We might be able to flip the Hyundai for like 20 grand because it's pretty new. Hasn't been driven that much. So, okay. Maybe we'll get out of this with about 30 grand, which is 7,500 each. Still not great, but better. So we shook hands on that. He shook hands on that, and we're good to go. Okay. So then we're presented with this issue of we have a name of a guy. We know he's in the city. How do you find him? Go ahead. Think about it. Like, feel free. Like, that's pretty much, that was the position we were in. That was the info I just told you. We have a name and we know he's in the city. What do you do to find this guy? Considering it's 2077, it's the future, it's the Matrix, it's all that, how do you find them? And that's really the beauty. That's why I think I really love Shadowrun. Is you just get thrown problems like that. Like, that's, Ziggy just gives you that. Gives you this problem, and then you just figure it out. Like, you know, I love problem solving. That's what I dig. So, yeah, I eat this shit up, man. There are a lot of ways that you could solve this issue. I'm sure you've thought of something already in your head. Is it going to be the same thing that I decided on? Maybe. Maybe not. I thought of it immediately and I was like, all right, I'm doing this. If I had a week to think about it, sure, I probably would have had something better, but this is what I went with. I decided to go to the airport and hack into their surveillance system and actually see him when he came through and what car he got into so I could track his vehicle. That's what I did. Fortunately, their surveillance system was not well protected. It wasn't too difficult to get in. This is not like the air traffic control center. Like, that would be much harder to get in. This is just the shitty airport in Milwaukee's surveillance system. Like, it's not going to be too tough. And Gug is pretty good at what he does. So that was not really an issue. But the problem was I didn't really get all the letters on his license plate. I got a few of them. And I got, like, the model. The make and model of it. I could tell. It was, I think that was the Ares. That was the Ares. So it was like a big truck. It was like an armored car, basically. So this guy is, he's getting into an armored vehicle outside of the airport. He's getting picked up. He's not taking a cab. So, he was expected, and he's someone that's not really unimportant. Which makes sense, because he's got a hit out on him. So I give the info that I got. The make, model, partial license plate to the group. And I'm like, okay, maybe like Smoove can go down to the DMV or something, sweet talk somebody, get into their records, find out maybe an address listed for this vehicle. We can go from there. And I figured that was pretty good. I mean, it wasn't stupendous. It required another step. But, I mean, as far as just one-stop shop for getting a good, solid lead, it was better than a bunch of ideas, right? So, yeah. I mean, that's what I did. I thought it was all right. So then we went to the meeting at the club. We all go to the club. It's bumping. We're all sitting down in the VIP lounge. And we sent a text to our contact from Lone Star. And I guess if you don't know what Lone Star is, there are basically two. Okay, so nowadays we have the police, right? Like, United States has police in each city. And it's just government funded, and they do their police things. In Shadowrun, in the future, not so much. That's not really a thing. Now it's all privatized. Because the government doesn't really do anything. And so there are basically two privatized... there are two privatized police forces. And they have contracts in a whole bunch of different cities. And the two are... Knight Errant and Lone Star. And so they kind of lose contracts occasionally and things like that. Like Lone Star had the Seattle contract, which is the biggest contract in the country, for a while, but then now Knight Errant recently got it because Lone Star kind of fucked up a big thing. And so now Lone Star is a bigger presence in the southern part of the country. It's not the United States of America anymore, but you get what I'm saying. The southern areas of the country, whereas Knight Errant is bigger. So Knight Errant is a division of Ares. So they're actually part of the Ares macro technology mega corporation. Because Ares is all about, you know, guns and enforcement and weaponry and all that kind of stuff. So they have their own privatized police force, and that's Knight Errant. Whereas Lone Star is an independent, they are their own corporation, and, Lone Star's thing is all about, like Texas justice. So they're not really known for their compassion. They're not really good guys. You kind of watch out when Lone Star's on the scene. And so Lone Star has, according to Ziggy's lore for the campaign, Lone Star has the contract for Milwaukee. Although that could change at any time if Lone Star messes up. Knight Errant could easily pick it up. Because that's exactly what happened in Seattle. And so The yeah, so we text our contact from Lone Star, who's a Lone Star sergeant, I guess. And we say, all right, you know, come over here. We're all sitting here. So he comes over, he sits down, and we have ourselves a little chat. And so he basically tells us about a job that Lone Star has for them, for us. And the job is that somewhere in the city of Milwaukee, there is a drug lab. And in this lab, they are, I guess, I don't even know if lab is the right word, but there's like a warehouse. There's like a distribution center, I guess, for a drug known as deep weed, which I know sounds funny. Yes, yes. And it's pretty much weed. It's a bit more magic-y than that, but for a non-magic person, it's basically weed. There are other drugs. Like Bliss is kind of weedish. Zen is kind of, actually, that's more of a hallucinogen. Yeah, so basically Bliss and deep weed. And deep weed is for more magically inclined characters. Interestingly enough, the only illegal drugs, like forbidden, in the core rulebook are Bliss and deep weed. And deep weed is like the most illegal and as well as the most expensive. It's $400 a pop for deep weed. I mean, this is all not until, you know, Vitesse hits the scene at $1,000 a pop, and it's going to be real illegal. but anyways, so deep weed, yeah, it's forbidden. They don't really want to spread it around. Although it's kind of funny, it's so illegal. I mean, yeah, it does kind of things for magic characters, but really not even that much. And otherwise, it's just basically marijuana. but it's so elite. Maybe that's some sort of commentary from the writers. I wouldn't doubt it. The only two forbidden drugs are the ones that just kind of relax you. As opposed to kamikaze, which basically makes you a bloodthirsty god of war. No joke. Like, it buffs, like, all your combat shit. Makes you move, like, 3 times as fast. Gives you high pain tolerance. And, you can get it with, like, a prescription. It's ridiculous. Maybe that's social commentary. Who knows? So, anyways, deep weed, yeah. It's basically marijuana. But they need to shut it down because that's part of their job. Unfortunately, they can't find the source of it. They have no idea where this distribution center is. And it's up to, they've kind of run out of things, and they need this problem solved. So, of course, like many corporations, they go to Shadowrunners to help them solve it. And right now, that is the Geek Squad. And yes, that is the name of our team, the Geek Squad, which I think I came up with. And it's funny, because geeking, to geek somebody in Shadowrun slang, is to kill them. That's what it means. Like, oh, he got geeked. That means they died. They got murdered. So we're the Geek Squad. It's funny. It's funny, all right? We were originally going to be like the Four Horsemen, but Charlie Chalk thought it was a bit too edgy, so we went with the Geek Squad, which is a bit more lighthearted. And actually, if I can talk about that, there are two types, more or less. I mean, these are the broad strokes. Two types of campaigns that you can run in Shadowrun. One is called Black Trench Coat. And Black Trench Coat is where, like, you take everything very gritty and seriously. Everything is kind of hyper-realistic. If you go down, you're down, you're done. It paints a very dark, grim picture of the setting and actions and things like that. And, you know, there's a lot of corporate espionage and backstabbing and stuff like that. That's Black Trench Coat. The other type is called Pink Mohawk. It is the opposite. That is where you basically look at things like a Michael Bay film. Everything explodes and is awesome and really cool. You don't really worry too much about realism or, oh, can my character do this? You know, you just ask, I don't know, is it cool? Yes. Well, then you can do it. I mean, it's kind of like that. It goes back more to Shadowrun's roots, where it's all kind of invested in 80s glam punk and things like that, you know, cyberpunk. But more or less, again, in a broad stroke, as a less serious, more just kind of exciting action fun campaign. I feel like we are leaning more towards the Pink Mohawk side than the Black Trench Coat side. Like, I feel like we want to just kind of play this by rule of cool, you know? We want to just worry about what's awesome and cool than just a really grim, serious... I just don't think we're the group for the Black Trench Coat major espionage grim stuff. That just doesn't seem our style. I like the Michael Bay stuff. That's really fun. And I think a lot of people that first start playing Shadowrun probably are going to lean towards that way, because especially if you come from something like D&D, like, oh man, it's so different. It's so different. Going from D&D to this is just like, my God. Or in the words of Charlie Chuck, we're not casting spells anymore. So yeah, it's very cool. So anyway, what was I talking about? So we were meant to find this deep weed distribution center. And so we asked what the pay was. What is the pay for a job like this? The pay that they offered was $8,000. And so Smoove was like, all right, look, listen here, John, like, you know, we don't, you know, we're not going to bullshit you around, and we would hope that you don't bullshit us around, so maybe we should, you know, think about this. And I just, like, butt in, because I'm uncouth. Gug is very uncouth. That's his quality. And he's just like, to put it less subtly, I don't take a shit for less than $10,000. And so he eventually is like, all right, I'm going to go make a few calls, see what I can do. And I, of course, had already hacked into his comlink, because that's what I do. If I'm not in your comlink, consider yourself very blessed. So I'm in his comlink, so I can see and hear, and everything that he does with his phone, I get to know about it. And I'm, of course, sharing this with the rest of the group. So he goes to a different area, and he starts texting his boss. And he's like, oh, I found, I think, what is a reliable a group, and I think they'll do it if we offer $12,000. And his boss is just like, God damn it, John, or, you know, Stanton, whatever. Fine, but if this doesn't work out, it's your ass. He's like, all right. So he comes back, he offers us $12,000, and potentially bonuses if we can find out who they are getting their supply from, if we can find out some concrete proof, you know, things like that. If we can show evidence and stuff. So we're like, all right, we are all in favor. We shake hands, job accepted. We have two jobs now, as well as a side work. And they all involve tracking down shit. So we get some info from him about where they've been kind of finding dealers for this deep weed. And we get a few possible locations. And Dante goes up to the owner of the club that we're in, who is one of his contacts, Nick the Greek, and asks him where a guy would get a hit of deep weed. And so Nick points him to the amphitheater to the south. That's apparently where they hang out after midnight to do their drug dealing. So we all decide, I mean, you know, it's getting close to midnight. We want to solve these jobs as quick as possible to get the most money. So I guess we'll just head down there, see if we can talk to a dealer, go undercover kind of, and maybe put a tracker on them and follow them back to their home base. So Smoove and Dante kind of go down into the amphitheater area. They're going to be the ones talking to him. And Thomas and I go up on a nearby roof and to provide kind of aerial support / sniper support. So Thomas, as the rigger, as the drone guy, he's got like remote control fly drones that are basically the size of a large fly, but they have cameras on them and stuff. And I, of course, have my sniper rifle, and I can hack and stuff like that. So we're providing support. He's flying around with his thing, and I got my scope in. And they eventually get approached by a couple dealers. one guy is kind of wearing, like a black guy with dreadlocks, and the other is like a huge troll there for security. And so Smoove kind of like modulates his voice with, you know, with tech, a voice modulator, to sound like kind of, he basically sounds Canadian. He made himself sound Canadian, more or less. And he's like, oh, yeah, I'm looking for some deep weed. You got some? He's like, yeah, I got some. And he's like, oh, where I'm from, a normal hit costs about 1,200 New Yen. Is that right around here? And he's like, oh, yeah, that's right. And keep in mind, normally it costs 400, which is, again, like the most expensive street drug. But 1,200 is ridiculous. I have no idea why he offered so much. Especially since he doesn't even have that much money on him. He had 500 New Yen on his person. That's it. He didn't have... And so, basically, he's like, oh, the dealer's like, you want to try it? Open your mouth. And so he gives Smoove a hit of deep weed. So he basically makes him puff the bong, I guess. And so, you know, Smoove gets a little high. He gets a little high going on. And then he starts to kind of antagonize. He's like, oh, man, that's not as good as I'm used to. You know, where do you get your stuff? And I'm like, God, what is he doing? And the guy's just like, how about you pay for your fucking sample? And I'm like, oh, my God. I just got my sniper scope just aimed down sights right on this duo. I'm ready to go. Armor-piercing rounds. I'll rock them real quick. And so Smoove's like, he sends like a message to me in with his trodes. And this is the importance of trodes, by the way. I mentioned this during the Matrix videos. Because normally, I mean, think about it from our perspective. If I'm in a situation like that and I want to send a text message to my buddy, I have to like either pull out my phone or I have to do some kind of like departed shit where you kind of text message from your pocket. With touch screens, that doesn't work at all. So you have to pull out your phone, which is bad. You don't want to do that. With trodes, you have the direct neural interface. So instead of finger typing your message, all you have to do is think your message and who you want to send it to, and boom, it's out there. So he sent me a message like, oh, Gug, help! And I'm like, God damn it! Like, there is no reason at all for him to say he normally pays $1,200 for a hit of deep weed. That didn't benefit us at all. Like, I still don't get it. I still don't get it. And so I'm like, God damn it. And so I wired him $1,200 because I actually had saved money over from character creation. So I had some cash on hand. But it's like, this is not how you make money. I'm loaning out money and I'm not getting any back. So I loan him because it's all just digital. It's like PayPal, basically. It's like instantaneous. I just wired the money from my comlink to his. Like, there you go. And so he sent the money over to the drug dealer. And I'm fairly certain, because I had already hacked into the drug dealer's comlink. And so I had already found his recent GPS coordinates and where he'd been hanging out. So I probably figured out where the hideout already was. This was already, like, done with. He could have just left, but it was like, okay. So I was in his comlink, so I probably could have just wired the money back to me. Like, I could have emptied his account and just, you know. And this is actually an interesting thing. This was something I looked up. I tried to find out so much last time. Like when we played Shadowrun last time, it's like the whole banking system. Like when you do New Yen, like when you buy things in Shadowrun, they just scan your like SIN. They scan your comlink. They don't even have to like pull out a device. Like it's all just wireless. But I would guess, you know, to actually authenticate it, you would have to acknowledge it. But, like, the money is all just freely available for you to just withdraw from your SIN. Like, any company can just withdraw the money if you authenticate it. Like, that has to be how it is, right? It's like swiping your card, you know? And so, what is stopping me from hacking somebody's comlink and just pressing the authenticate button to withdraw all their money into my comlink. Like, like, that seems so easy. Now, yeah, if they are, like, a legal citizen, there's obviously very clear records about this. But how I got around that the last time we played was I just withdrew the money onto a cred stick. Because cred sticks are basically untraceable. Because it's just, it's like a USB drive of money. And I don't think Nuyen is, like, digitally marked. Like, I don't think you can tell the source of any one Nuyen and where it's been. Maybe. I think maybe a really clever DM might introduce that, and I would be like, well, damn. But this guy was not a legal citizen, so he was not going to probably go to the cops that I had stolen his money. But anyways, I didn't do it because I figured if he found out, that would directly threaten my boys on the ground out there, and I didn't want to do that, so I was like, whatever, it's not that much money. Anyways, so Dante is kind of standing nearby, just like mean mugging these drug dealers the whole time. Like, he's just wearing sunglasses at night, and he's just not saying a word at all. So he's like creeping out the drug dealers. And so they eventually decide that this isn't really worth their time, and they're going to split. Because Smoove was not really being that cooperative. He was kind of just asking questions about where they got this and stuff like that. So, like, we're out of here. And so Smoove tries to palm a stealth tag, like a tracker tag, into one of their pockets as they're leaving. But he doesn't succeed on his roll. So they notice it. They basically throw it on the ground and stomp it and, like, let's get out of here. And I was like, wow, I was really surprised because I thought they would either not notice, or if they did notice, they would immediately just start, like, blasting them. But apparently they were so weirded out by Dante and his sunglasses that they didn't want to mess with him, so they just ran off. So we had our fly drone, following them, and I fired a tracker round from my sniper rifle into the troll's armor. I doubt he noticed, because he's kind of thick, literally and figuratively. But I wanted to track around at him just in case. And they basically just kind of ran off for a little bit, and then they kind of turn around and they just didn't do much. Because we figured we have the coordinates for where they hang out, which is another club. It's a different club called Silk something, the Silk Trade or something like that, which is apparently another Asian, it's an Asian themed club. For the record, Ziggy knows that our plan is to get a plane and go to Hong Kong, which I would imagine is why he's introducing a lot of kind of Asian elements to the story, which is good. It's fine. So we're like, all right, let's just go to there, check it out, see if we can find out some evidence, and maybe that's where the distribution center is, in like the basement or something. So we head on over to this club, and There's a big line to get in. And we don't have any chicks with us, which is usually the quick way to get into a club. We don't have any chicks, so it's going to be rough. So Smoove goes up to the bouncer, the list guy, and he tries to talk his way in. Because we had heard the troll's name from the drug dealers. We knew his name was Cujo. So Smoove tried to name drop that. He's like, Cujo owes me a favor. And I owe, the club owner owes me a favor, and people don't need to owe me favors, so, let me in, we're going to talk this out. And the guy's just like, you're not on the list, I've never heard of no Cujo, blah, blah, blah. So what I did is I'm standing there, I hack into the guy's earpiece, and I basically just transmit my voice into his ear, and I kind of, like, gruff it up a little bit, and I'm like, let this guy and his crew inside. And so I had to roll a con, of which I suck at. Like, I'm very specialized. I took a huge amount of skill points, but I still feel so specialized. And whenever I do something that I'm not good at, it's just terrible. But I managed to get, like, one success because I re-rolled it all with an edge point, which was probably a waste, as I found out later on. But he let us in, so we all got to go in for free, which was good. Hacking, man. It does stuff. So we go inside this club, and it's bumping. It is bumping in there. They got a DJ. They got multiple floors of dancing areas and, you know, bars and stuff like that. And the best thing that we see for, you know, shady stuff is that there is an elevator in kind of the lobby. And there's nobody guarding it, but it's keypad protected. So I'm like, all right, that's probably our best way in. Smoove immediately hits the dance floor, and he starts he starts dancing with, like, this Asian girl and hitting on her. He's like, hey, girl, you got any deep weed? She's like, oh, no, I don't do that, but I help get you off. And Smoove is just like, oh, girl, I can't get it up without some deep weed. Dude, it's so different than D&D, man. So different. It was hilarious. You had to be there. Maybe you didn't. It might still be funny. I think it is. She's like, oh, no, I don't do that. I'm sorry. And I'm just like, that's not going anywhere. And so I figured, now we all kind of just are scoping out the place, things like that. But I figured that the best thing to do is to go hit the elevator. Like, that's probably going to, that's where everything is. We got to get to the elevator. And so I can just plug into the kind of the elevator keypad to open it up and get access. But it's in the middle of kind of the lobby. So I need a distraction. I need a distraction in an Asian nightclub. If this invokes an image from a movie, we're on the same wavelength. So what I do is I hack into the stereo, or into the speaker system. And I basically transfer audio control from the DJ to Smoove. So anything that he says into his microphone is going over the speakers. And I also take control of the lights, and I put a spotlight on him. And he uses his voice modulator to sound like the DJ. And he introduces himself, and he begins doing karaoke. Karaoke in an Asian nightclub as everybody just stares at him. And yes, the movie I'm thinking of is Rush Hour 2. It was exactly like that, and by God, it was funny. He was the Chris Tucker for our group for a while. And it was just so great. Like, I just, it was like, oh, I gotta just hack into the speakers. Boom. Go. So he starts performing. He's got the spotlight on him. And I'm like, that's exactly the distraction I needed. So I go over to the elevator. I hack it open. And I'm like, all right, it's all good. And so we decide to send Dante and the fly drone. And they go to the... Well, they try to go to the basement first, but they're unable. They need, like, a key card. So they go to the... They go to the roof. They go to the roof, and the door's open. And Dante was pretty smart. He basically, like... He's basically, like, clinging to the ceiling with, like, some martial arts shit. And so the doors to the elevator open at the roof. And it basically looks like it's empty. Which was good, because there were four armed guards on the roof with automatic weapons. And so they just kind of see an empty elevator, and they start wandering over there. And I'm, of course, looking through the drone's eyes, the camera of the drone. I'm like, okay, let's close these doors. Let's send them down. So they go to the second floor, and it's basically... It's basically that was the other dance floor. There was another dance floor right above the first one. So nothing really interesting there. So we're like, okay, we need to get into the basement then. And so the concept was, I was going to maybe go up to a nearby roof and start picking off the guards on the roof, and maybe one of them would have a key card. But we decided that if I could just break into the elevator, somebody could break into the elevator, like, control panel, maybe I could override the restriction for the basement and just get somebody down there. That's basically what happens. But Smoov was in a bit of a pickle because all the security was converging on him. Because he had basically hacked into they thought he had hacked into everything, and he was just taking over, and he was ruining their whole thing. This Guilo, or whatever they call it, was ruining their club. So he had basically had four security guards closing in on him as he's doing karaoke. And so it's up to Gug to save him yet again. So I thought this was pretty clever of me. Not to brag. I'm sorry. That was bragging. What I did was I was like, all right, Zig, I'm going to do a few things really quick. I'm going to cut off Smoove's access to the speakers. I'm going to raise the music real loud. And I'm going to set the lights to strobe. And it was just kind of the perfect storm. So the thing is, in Roll 20, Ziggy actually has like a jukebox, and he can send music over to our computers and stuff. So he actually raised like a club music soundtrack, and he described Smoove's efforts of getting away from these security guards amid this strobing light. It was great. It was so perfect. So Smoove got out unscathed, and he popped into the elevator with Dante. They popped open kind of the control panel for the elevator. They threw a data tap onto the cabling, and I was basically in. And so I sent him down to the basement. The elevator doors open in the basement floor, and it was like a corridor, I guess. And there was a camera and a turret, like a security turret on the ceiling. So Smoove immediately quick drawed his revolver and shot the camera in one go. Just boom. I'm like, yeah, they probably know you're there, but okay. Like, shooting it is basically the same thing as not shooting it. And to be fair, like, strictly speaking, like, if we used all the Matrix rules, I probably could have just gone into virtual reality and just scanned, like, the entire building for every device. I mean, yeah, it was probably some of it was running silent, but I could have found everything. And so I could have known there was a turret there before they went down. But this provides some excitement to it. Like, I don't want to cheese everything with the Matrix. There are things that I could have done during the session that I know I could have done. But just for the sake of excitement and not me just overwhelming everything, I was just like, oh, we'll just do it as it is. So I'm like, I send like a text message to the group that they all get the little notification. I'm like, they probably know you're here. And so they kind of step out of the elevator and they start kind of glancing around when suddenly the back door or like the back wall of the elevator like slides open and a guy steps out. So we all roll initiative. Even though Thomas and I are not really there, we can go into the Matrix in virtual reality, so we can technically do things. And here's where I guess it kind of gets... I think it's better than any other addition for a situation like this, but it's still not perfect. So as I talked about during the Matrix stuff and the combat stuff, when you roll initiative and you're in VR, you're in virtual reality, you get a whole bunch of dice and a bonus, and you get to roll initiative, and it's quite a bit because you're thinking digitally. It's fast. The problem is, like, Dante, as an adept, has basically like the same initiative, if not higher than us. Like, he's in the meat world. We're thinking at the speed of light. He's faster than us. It's ridiculous. And also, the other side of it, then, is for his turn in this situation, his turn is he brings up his gun and he shoots the guy. He might kill him, he might injure him, he might miss, whatever. He's shooting his gun, boom, done. For me, though, the only thing that I really had was either I could, like, go and break the other guy's weapon or disrupt it in some way, or I can hack the security turret and use that to fire. Both ways are pretty similar in... Well, actually, no. Breaking the gun would have been faster, but it wouldn't have really done much. So I went for the security turret. I want to hack the security turret and fire it. Which means I have to spend my whole turn to get a mark onto the turret. Then I have to spend my whole next turn getting a mark on the turret. And then my third turn, if the guy's still alive, I can fire the turret and hopefully hit him and kill him. The guy was not going to be alive by that point. No way. We had two. We had the combat god adept in there, and then we had Smoov, who actually did kill the guy. Surprisingly, Dante did not. He did not do well with his rolls. But actually, it was like one turn. Like, it wasn't even like a full initiative pass before the guy was dead, because Smoov just put a bullet in his head. And so yeah, I mean, it makes sense, I guess. Like, I am, again, not to brag, but just deckers in general are immensely useful to the game of Shadowrun. And so it makes kind of sense that when combat happens, I have basically either not done my job well or just shit has kind of gone wrong. So it's time for me to just step aside a little bit and let other characters shine. Namely, like Dante, you know, people that are actually there. I could have definitely been there with them, but I really wouldn't have done that much anyways. My initiative in the meat world sucks, and I would have just basically fired my pistol and maybe hit him. That's why I like beating the guy on the roof that can just... I like sniping, and I like hacking. It's just a good combo. It's just in the basement of a nightclub. Doesn't really work. So anyways, they drop the guy before I can really control the turret. And they go into this room that now opened up. And they find it's basically like the security center, and they find the surveillance center, the tech center of the whole club, and they find the tech guy like huddled under the desk, and so Smoov like drags him out, like punches him in the stomach and pistol whips him, and like just ridiculous. He gets really Jack Bauer on him. It's crazy. I did not expect it from Smoov. He's like, tell me where the goddamn lab is. And so the guy tells him where it is, and he tells him like where the cabling is so he can hook in another data tap so that I can hook into their whole security system and control everything. And again, to be perfectly, you know, legit, rules as written for the game, this is not really how data taps work. It's kind of fuzzy, but... like, the way that we used it in the session, again, it's not how it's meant to be. The way we used it was basically to get a remote access to a direct connection. Direct connection is, like, what you want as a decker. That's the idea, is you want to directly connect into everything because it's easier to hack. And so they don't give you remote access to that because that's ridiculous. You actually have to be there to direct connect. It's just a little plug-in. And so the data tap lets you, like, hook into a cabling... and it lets you get direct access to the devices that are on either side of the cable. And I guess... I kind of want to double check this, but I believe that if the data tap is wirelessly activated, you can then access the data tap remotely, which I guess has direct connection. Like, it's really kind of weird. And I'd have to find out where the hell this shit is. Actually, it doesn't even say that. It does have a wireless feature, so it can be wirelessly activated. But the wireless lets you, like, remotely destruct the data tap, so it just, like, leaves no evidence. It doesn't really say that you can access the devices through the data tap wirelessly. We just kind of made it that way. I don't think that's actually as intended, because then that means we could do what I did, where we can just, like, we can wirelessly direct connect to devices just through cabling, that so I can sit outside the building and they can just data tap cables. For one, cables are not common. They are not common. It's basically the equivalent of using dial-up in today's world. It just does not happen. It's archaic. It's for people that either are really damn poor or cheap or just nostalgic or something like that. Or if it's like an uber security measure where you have a completely contained device that is 100% wired and has no wireless whatsoever. This stuff all had wireless. There's no reason for it to have cabling at all, but I digress. It works. Again, rule of cool. It just kind of does what it does. So anyways, so I owned their whole security system. I'm in everything. And so we find out there the distribution lab, whatever, is right on, it's in the basement, it's nearby. We have security cameras in there. There's like four guards, there's a couple of workers, and there's a whole bunch of deep weed in there. It's like, oh god. Do you guys have any explosives? And the only explosive they had was one high explosive grenade. Like, that's crazy. That was crazy to me. Like, I mean, I know, I always love explosives. I mean, I always have a bunch. But why would you only buy one? That seems so strange. I guess if you're really strapped for cash. But I don't have one of, like, anything. Well, I mean, I guess some things. Like, I'm not going to buy two grapple guns. But anything that's kind of usable, like, it gets used up. I have at least five. Anyways, so the plan was to just run in there, I guess, throw the high explosive grenade, let it blow up everything, get out of there. Problem was, we had kind of triggered an alarm, and I was not in the system before the alarm went off, so security was notified. I did control the elevator, however, so I did override their access to the elevator. They couldn't go down the elevator. They did have rope ladders, though, up on the roof, so they sent down rope ladders. They were going to come around, and they were going to get their way into the basement eventually, no matter what. Surprisingly, the guys in the basement weren't... Well, I think they were, but the guys in the lab or whatever didn't really react at all to the alarm. I guess they were just kind of finishing up. Who knows? But it didn't seem like there was any other way out of the basement other than the elevator, so I don't know what their plan was. The other thing was that the lab had a couple of turrets in it. I had full control of these turrets. And so, I cleared out the lab real quick. It was cool. It was badass. They had no chance. It was a kill box, man. Dante ran in to kind of throw this grenade, but he was interrupted by a kind of, like, the security lieutenant. And so he kind of had a quick duel with this guy, but you one-on-one, Dante will win. He will win. His roles are insane, man. It's ridiculous. So I look forward to what Ziggy kind of comes up with to throw at Dante to just shut him down. Because if you just throw regular grunts at him, you can do that all day. Dante's not going to stop. It's insane. That's what adepts do, man. So he puts down this guy, he throws the high explosive in, everything blows up, and Smoove executes the tech guy for no reason whatsoever. Just chrome to the dome, bullet to the brain, blown away, done. And I'm just like, God, we didn't even get paid for him, why would you kill him? Like, what was the point? He's seen my face, man. He didn't say that, but I could picture him saying that. He's seen my face. So we decide that while we could just go out the front door, at this point everybody had kind of panicked and left, like all the guests had all left, and so we felt like somebody was probably going to be out the front door, like what? There was probably going to be police or something, so not a really good idea. So maybe let's go to the roof where they have the rope ladders. And by the way, we know about all the rope ladders and stuff like that because the fly drone was sitting on the roof the whole time. So we had a camera on the roof the entire time. As well as I was in the security cameras as well at this point, so I saw everything. So we're like, okay, they have rope ladders up there. We can go up there. We can kind of sneak away off the roof into a different area and just kind of get out of here. So I bring the elevator up to the first floor. We get on. We go all the way up to the roof. And we're like, okay, there are the rope ladders. And Thomas like remote controls and brings his van over near to the building on the sides, so we can all just kind of climb in right away and get out of here. But while he does that, his drone gets squashed by something. I don't know if I don't remember what it was. Oh, it was squashed by the guy that we're looking for. The Chinaman, or the Japanese guy that we're looking for the other client. He was the guy that was living in, like, this penthouse at the top of this nightclub that we were looking, like, boom, he was right there. He squashed the drone, and we got to see his face. Because we had seen his face at the airport and went from the cameras. So, when a drone that you're like jumped into as a rigger, when it like gets destroyed, if it has hitboxes of health, if it takes damage, you take half that damage as biofeedback. But these tiny little drones don't even have a box of health. Like, if they get touched, they basically die. But if something you're in dies or explodes or whatever, you get dumped out of virtual reality. You suffer dump shock. So he suffered some dump shock damage. A bunch of it. Which he was in cold sim, so it was basically just sun damage. And so we're like, okay, we got the van there. We got the rope ladders. We can get out of here. But, and I think this was partly my fault, but I think Smoov was right there with me. What about this penthouse that's up here on this roof? Like, it was like a separate little building on the roof that the guards were, like, you know, guarding. Like, there's got to be something good in there. So, of course, we take the time. I think we already knew that the police was, like, gathering towards the front of the building. Maybe not, but I don't know. We went over to the penthouse. The door was ajar. We went in. Smoov ended up finding, like, a secret door, which was crazy. We go into the secret room, and there's basically nothing really in there. Everything had been kind of swept clean in a hurry. The only thing that was left in there was a gun. And I'm like, oh, you know, what kind of gun? What is this? He's like, oh, it's like a Ranger, something. Like a Ranger Arms or, yeah, Ranger Arms SM5. I think it's like a sniper. And I'm like, are you shitting me? And the Ranger Arms SM5 is the best sniper rifle in the core rulebook. It might be the best sniper rifle from any of the books. Hold on, I have to look. It's worth 28,500 New Yen. It's a lot. Oh no, the Terracotta Arms is 35 grand. And the Barrett Model 122 is 38 grand. But those are from the from the core rulebook, this one is the top thing. Like, it's amazing. It's really good. It is just a straight upgrade in every stat from my current one, which is already really good. So I was like, oh my god, I struck gold. This is amazing. Like, even like the description of it. A legendary assassin's weapon. That's what it calls it. Like, this thing is just sitting here in this room, and I'm like, oh, it's amazing. So I just pick it up, put it in my bag immediately. And it disassembles completely in order to fit into a standard briefcase. It's so good. So anyways, really good gun. I was amazed to find it. So we're like, all right, I mean, that's pretty much here. Everything else behind it kind of been swept clean. So we grab that and we head back out. And so now at this point, yeah, the police are everywhere. I know the story's running long. We're about to come to a close. So the police are all over the place. They're building up a perimeter. And I'm like, damn, we need like a major distraction. There are so many things that I could have done as a distraction other than the thing that I chose. But I chose what I chose. And I definitely regret it. I could have easily hacked into any one of their vehicles and started just tearing ass. I could have had, you know, Thomas rig into his... He had a combat drone nearby. He had a combat drone that was fully armed. But I think overall, what happened... Well, it was not preferred. But of the things that I could have done as a distraction, this was probably the best choice for what ended up... Anyways, let me just get to it. What I decided to do was like, all right, we need a distraction. So how about we, like, point them in the wrong direction? We, like, get them looking in a different direction so we can get in the van and get out of here. So what I had on me was my grenade launcher. Yeah, because I love explosives, I love grenades, so my grenade launcher has, like, everything. It's got flashbangs, frag grenades, high explosive, gas grenades, smoke grenades. So I'm like, alright, I don't want to hurt them or anything like that. They're not hurting us, so let's just pull out a flashbang, fire it, like, across the street so they'll think something's going on over there, shit's going down, and we'll be able to just get out of here. So I load it up, I aim it, and I pull the trigger, and I critically glitch. That is basically the equivalent of rolling a 1. But it's almost even worse than that. It's like if you roll 2 ones in a row. That's kind of what it's like. A glitch is when you roll, say you roll 6 dice. If 3 of them or more are ones, it's called a glitch. You roll half or more, the number of your dice that you rolled are ones. That's called a glitch. And that's bad, but it's usually not catastrophic. You still end up generally resolving and doing what you wanted, but there's a kind of an unintended bad side effect. That would have been all right. But no. I rolled a critical glitch, which is when you roll the same thing, but you don't get any hits. You don't get any fives and sixes with that same roll. So you accomplish nothing, and you did it spectacularly. So what had happened was because my thing has an airburst link, which means that I can wirelessly like hit like a little button on the grenade launcher, and the mini grenade will explode at any point when I hit the button instead of just when, at a timer or whatever like that. So you use it to just explode them remotely in the air. I guess because Gug had not used... I think this was like the first time Gug had ever used the grenade launcher because he'd never been in a situation where he needed it. I think it was his first time ever. So I think he accidentally hit the airburst link thing immediately after pulling the trigger. So basically, as soon as this mini flashbang grenade, left the barrel of a grenade launcher, it exploded as we were all standing there. So what does it do? What does a flashbang do? It doesn't just blind you and deafen you. That would have been great. That would have been worked. Well, it would have been great, but we would have worked out. No, what it does is just stun damage. It just does stun damage. It does a massive amount of stun damage. And because none of us were expecting it, we didn't get to roll our defense. If we had, we may have been okay. But no, we got no defense. We were point blank with no compensation. We had to take 10 points of stun damage each. I only have 9 boxes for my stun damage. If you take up to your stun damage, as many as you take, you are immediately unconscious. I immediately, instantly knocked unconscious 3 of the 4 members of our team. With 1 flashbang right in all of our faces. It all was Gug's fault. Oh, man. Like, that mission went south so fast. So, what about the fourth guy? Of course, the fourth guy was Dante. Dante has, like, combat reflexes or some shit, which means he can never... Well, he gets to make a roll against being ever surprised. And Ziggy counted this as a surprise attack. So he got to make his roll for his perception, which was only like 6 dice, and he still did it. So he still did it. He made the roll, so he wasn't surprised, which means he got to roll his defense. Of course, he crushed it because he rolls like 20 dice for his defense. I don't know how. And so he basically took 2 stun damage from a flashbang in his face. Insane. Fucking adepts, man. It's ridiculous. So he took 2 stun damage, but now he's in a pickle, because the rest of his team is unconscious on the top of a roof, surrounded by Lone Star agents. He tries to quickly patch me up, because if I'm up, I can do some hacking. There's a helicopter above us, by the way. I didn't mention that. So maybe I can hack the helicopter, send it flying into the cars on the ground, make a big explosion, get us out of here. So he tries desperately to patch me up. It takes him 2 attempts. I get 1 stun damage, like, removed. So I'm conscious, but I'm shit. So I try instantly to hack the helicopter. I, of course, fail. So then I'm like, okay, I can either pull out my grenade launcher again and blow, like, a high explosive round upwards, straight upwards at this helicopter. You know we're all going to die. I'm just going to kill us if I do that. So I'm like, okay, I'm going to take out my grapple gun and try to grapple onto the helicopter. I succeed, and I activate, like, the internal winch in the grapple gun, and I start just getting pulled upwards. And I'm like, I don't even know what I'm doing, but I'm, like, half unconscious still. And I'm not making smart decisions.
So I'm in the air, grappled on to a helicopter, and the guy up there, like the goon that's up there, he takes like his rifle or whatever, his minigun, I don't even know what it was, and of course he hits me. I think it was just like a submachine gun or something. So if he had just shot me in the leg and I had taken some physical damage, it would have been fine, because I could have just shot at him back afterwards and killed him and whatever. But no, because his bullets were so weak, they didn't pierce my armor, which means they do stun damage instead of physical damage if any damage goes through. So I took 2 points of stun damage, which, if you remember, I was near unconscious. So I went back unconscious, which I was holding onto a grapple gun attached to a helicopter in the air. So I plummeted down to the ground, and I filled up my entire physical bar instantly. So I was bleeding out on top of the roof, surrounded by police. So Dante tried once again to patch me up so I wouldn't die, but he failed because he has no points in first aid. It was terrible. So, yeah, it's not looking good. But the police are, like, they're coming upstairs. Like, they're going to be here any second. So they'll probably patch me up because that's what cops do, right? I mean, that's what cops do nowadays. I don't know about Lone Star. They might just put a bullet in me and end me, but I have to hold out. I have to just hope. That's all I have at this point. So now Dante has the choice of either, like, surrendering to the police or just running away. He decides to run away. So he gets fired upon a bunch, but he's an adept. I don't know if he even took damage. So he got out of there. He jumped in Lake Michigan, and he got out of there. And that's where we ended. That's how our session ended. It turned south so instantly quick. So, Ren linked the image afterwards from Anchorman, where he's like, you know, that escalated quickly. Really got out of hand. It's like, yes, it did. It's all my fault because I didn't put a single point into heavy weapons, even though I knew I had a grenade launcher and I was going to be using it. Like, I put points into, like, palming, stealing shit, instead of heavy weapons. I don't know what I was thinking. So yeah, we're gonna go to jail, of course, and all our shit's gonna be taken, of course, and our sins are gonna be burned, because they're gonna find out they're fake instantly, so that sucks. Overall, we're gonna lose more money on this job than we made. But the question is, are we gonna get out of jail? Well, of course we're gonna get out of jail. And I don't mean that to be, like, confident. I mean that to say that if we're not going to get out of jail, Ziggy's going to tell us, you're not going to get out of jail, make new characters. He's not going to do that because that's just a dick move. And so it's just kind of a meta thing where it's like, yeah, we're going to get out. It just depends at what cost. Here's the thing, though, the kind of way I looked at it. We were there. I mean, for one, we busted up an illegal drug distribution center. And the only people that died were drug dealers. So it's kind of a vigilante thing. But on the even pluser side, we were there because we were hired by these cops. That's a big plus for us. And plus, plus, plus is we did not kill or incapacitate or harm in any way any of the Lone Star people. Like, none of them. They didn't get fired upon. They didn't get shot at. Like, Dante just kind of ran. I mean, yeah, I maybe shot a grapple gun, but that was about it. So I think with all that combined, we'll probably get off pretty easy. We're going to have to buy new sins because those are going to get burned. That sucks because that costs a lot of money. I don't know if they'll let me keep that sniper rifle, which is really sad. Because it's forbidden, but so is the current one I have. If Ziggy takes away both of those sniper rifles, Jesus, man. Like, that is so much. Like, I'm going to have to break into, I will break into the Lone Star place to get my guns back. I don't care. So maybe that'll happen. But yeah, overall, crazy. Like, it's just so different than D&D. It's so great. It's so good. It's just so cool they'd be modern and but with tech and all the technology, and it's just so different. And, oh man, it's so good. And, like, you know, as far as problem solving goes, like, this is the cream of the crop. For somebody like me that just digs that, this is as good as it gets, and it's great. So, yeah, I'm really excited about this campaign. I hope it goes on for a while. I mean, yeah, like, combat and stuff was relatively slow.
for this session because, like, people, like, this is the first time, like, they're learning the system, they're learning characters, like, they're looking up, like, what to roll, and I basically had to guide everybody through combat situations, but if we play for, like, a year, people are going to have things down. So, yeah, crazy stuff. Really looking forward to everything. And it's like, yeah, I could just make a new character and say Gug gets arrested and thrown in jail for the rest of his life, blah, 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 and just make a new character. But here's the thing. I want to play a Decker. And our group needs a Decker. And so it's like, okay, I'm going to play a Decker. So it's either Gug or it's a different Decker character. And it's like, Gug, like, I spent so much time with, you know, Gug's character sheet. Like, this is all set. Like, I want to play Gug, man. So, yeah, I'm going to get out of prison. I'm going to get all my shit back. And it's going to be all right. Trust me. It's going to be all right. So this was a long episode, but really a lot happened. I think this was, like, the longest session uninterrupted that we've played on Roll20. Like, we went pretty late. But, yeah, it was good. It was really good. All right. So there will probably be another Shadowrun video during the week where I talk about all the cool shit you can buy. I'm looking forward to making that. And then we'll be back for session two. So my name is Mang. This has been Roll Manging for our Shadowrun 5th edition campaign of the Geek Squad. And I'll see you fine folks next week.